As we all are surrounded by portable gadgets, we are familiar with batteries. From a toy car to your smartphone, everything has a battery which gives its power. Likewise, EVs are also running on batteries, which we'll be talking more about in this session. Welcome back everyone to a new session of EV Talk. Today we are going to talk more about lithium-ion batteries and battery management system in EV. Before we start the session, let me give you a heads up. We won't be discussing much about the battery chemistry and the history of battery in this session. We'll include those in our upcoming sessions. The first battery was designed by Alessandro Volta in early 1800s. From then, scientists are trying to perfect batteries. And there were many battery designs, out of which in EV industry, there are only three significant batteries. The first one is lead acid, the second one is nickel metal hydride batteries, and the third one is lithium ion. Even now, batteries are the most researched subject in EV industry. Nickel metal batteries lasted only for a few years after its invention. But lead acid batteries are very common. It is often used as a storage battery or as a secondary battery. So in this video, we will only discuss about lead acid battery and lithium ion battery. You all might have seen lead acid batteries in car or in power backup system at your home. As you can see here in this representation, there will be a positive and a negative terminal on the battery pack, and there will be some tubes to fill diluted sulfuric acid. In lead acid battery, the electrodes are lead oxide and pure lead, which will be dipped into a diluted sulfuric acid. Over time, this sulfuric acid gets drained and we'll have to refill it periodically. On the other hand, lithium ion batteries are very simple. We'll just have to stack up the lithium ion cells to make a battery pack, and we'll get the power from the terminals. But in high-end system, there will be a circuit which will monitor the cell health and control the charging and discharging. This circuit is called battery management system. We'll talk more about it later. Now let's look at the major advantages of lithium-ion batteries. One of the major reasons lithium-ion is so significant is the cost. Comparing to a lead-acid battery, the cost of lithium-ion batteries are very less for a given volume and the energy capacity. Lithium-ion batteries also have a very high energy density. That means it can store energy approximately 10 times that of a lead-acid battery in a same size. The time taken to charge lithium-ion battery from 0 to 100 is very less comparing to the lead-acid batteries. Battery charging is a major bottleneck in EV industry, which is solved to an extent by lithium-ion batteries. Lithium-ion batteries can provide long range because large amount of energy can be stored in a small size. Range of the vehicle is a major concern when it comes to EV industry, and lithium-ion batteries are solving that to an extent. Self-discharging is a property of batteries where the charge inside the battery will drain automatically. In the case of lithium-ion batteries, the self-discharge is very less, and it's okay to keep the battery idle for a long time. In the case of lead-acid batteries, changing the sulfuric acid is only a major hassle. But in lithium-ion cells, there is no maintenance at all. The battery pack will work until there is an issue in the cells. And to monitor those cells, we have a BMS inside. It will notify the user that there is an error in the battery and it needs to be replaced. Now let's move on to the architecture of lithium-ion cell. As you saw in the previous picture, number of lithium-ion cells are joined to get a lithium-ion battery pack. Here is a representation of lithium-ion cell. There are four major parts for a lithium-ion cell: cathode, anode, electrolyte, and a separator. In lithium-ion cell, the cathode will be a lithium metal oxide and the anode will be graphite. Let's say we separate the lithium atom from the lithium metal oxide. The separated lithium atom is unstable so that it forms a lithium ion and an electron instantly. Likewise, we separate multiple lithium ions. All these lithium ions will be stored in the anode. How to do that? So, the ions can pass through the electrolyte to reach anode, but electrons won't be able to do that. So we'll have to make two separate paths for electrons and the ions. Here, the electrons will move through the yellow path to the anode, and the ions will take the blue path. So now the ions and the electrons are in the anode. This is a very unstable state. So the moment we connect a load, the electrons will flow through the load to reach the cathode, and to be in an equilibrium, the ions will move through the electrolyte to reach the cathode. This is how a battery works. So the process which we did to separate the lithium ions and store it in the anode is called charging. So this is how it looks like. We connect a power supply across the cell so that the lithium ions will be separated and it will be moved to the anode, and the electrons will be moved through the power supply to the anode. Each cell can give up to 4 volt. According to the requirement, the cells will have to be stacked up in series and parallel connection. There are 3 major types of lithium ion cells: cylindrical cell, pouch type and prismatic type. You may be familiar with cylindrical and pouch type cells. The batteries in your smartphone and other portable gadgets are pouch type, and lithium ion cells, which are similar to AA batteries, are cylindrical type. Prismatic cells are made up of many positive and negative electrodes sandwiched together, leaving more possibility for short circuit and inconsistency. The high capacity make it difficult for BMS to protect each cell from overcharging and dissipating heat. In EV industry, we use both cylindrical and prismatic cells for batteries. In a standard range Tesla Model 3, there are almost 3000 cylindrical cells. These cells are stacked and kept under the floor. For EVs with portable batteries, we can design it in custom shape and size. Continuous charging and discharging of these cells are a bit risky, so we'll have to monitor the health of each cell and maintain an ideal temperature. For this, there will be a coolant running through the batteries, and this will be controlled by the BMS. So this is the basic architecture of a BMS. Here, as you can see, there is a cell monitoring section and an input-output section. Apart from the power lines, there is a CAN bus communication happening in the input-output section. This CAN bus is enabling the communication between the charger, the speed gauge and the BMS. So here, all the cells are connected to the BMS through these cell banks. So each particular module of stacked cells are called cell bank, and each cell bank will be connected to the BMS. For cooling, there is a fan, and this fan switch is also controlled by the BMS. If the temperature of the battery increases, this fan will be turned on and it will cool down. There are also battery packs with liquid coolants. In cars and all, we are using liquid coolants. Connecting the CAN port to a laptop or a diagnostic port will allow the user to see what's happening inside the battery, what is the status of each cell of the battery, and if there is any issue or any other problem inside the battery, that will also be flagged. BMS also manages the charging and discharging of the battery. So there are thousands of cells inside a battery, so each cell has to be uniformly charged and discharged, or else it will be overcharged. So this will also be taken care of by the BMS. We'll have a separate section on BMS. For now, this will be enough. Charging an electric vehicle is a simple process. You simply plug your car into a charger that is connected to an electric grid. However, not all EV charging stations are created equal. Some can install simply by plugging into a standard wall outlet, while the others require custom installation. So the charging is divided into 3 categories: level 1, level 2 and level 3 charging stations. Level 1 EV charging stations use 120 volt AC and can be plugged into any standard outlet. You don't need any electricians to set up this charging station. Level 2 EV charging stations are used for both residential and commercial charging stations. They use 240 volt or 208 volt. Unlike level 1 chargers, they can't be plugged into any standard outlet. Instead, they are usually installed by a professional electrician. Level 2 electric car charger deliver 10 to 60 miles of range per hour of charging. They can fully charge an electric battery in a little like 2 hours, making them ideal option for home charging and for public charging stations. Then there is level 3 charging station, also known as DC fast chargers. It can offer 60 to 100 miles of range for electric cars in just 20 minutes. However, they are typically only used in commercial and industrial application. They require high specialized, high powered equipment to install and maintain. We'll try to make separate session for charging stations and BMS to give you more details. I hope in today's section you understood what is the significance of lithium-ion battery, how it works, and how important is a battery management system in lithium-ion battery packs. Thank you for your time. We'll see you in the next session.